recognition of the Dizzy Gillespie Memorial Fund, which is a wonderful fundraiser that comes to the aid of musicians who find themselves in catastrophic illnesses and substance abuse. The fund underwrites the cost of hospitalization, diagnostic tests, and a full range of medical services for jazz musicians who are uninsured and in distress. Since its formation, the Dizzy Gillespie Memorial Inglewood Hospital Fund has donated over $5 million in hospital services to jazz musicians, 100% donor related. Up next, we have the pleasure of speaking with actor, New York Times best-selling author, son of Peter Lawford and Pat Kennedy, who is the sister of John F. Kennedy, Christopher Lawford Kennedy. Mr. Lawford holds a Bachelor's of Arts from Tufts University, a JD from Boston College Law School, and a Master's Certification in Clinical Psychology from Harvard Medical School, where he gained an academic appointment as a lecturer in psychology. Christopher Lawford is also a recovering drug addict in recovery for more than 26 years. And his most recent book, Recover to Live, Kick Any Habit, Manage Any Addiction, educates as well as motivates transformational personal change, quite possibly altering the way broader society looks at those suffering from addiction.
Hey, what's up, y'all? This is your girl, Carla B, and we are here for the eBuzz Talk Show. We have a guest, Christopher Kennedy Lawford.
Yeah, my mother didn't give me a middle name when I was born. She gave me her name when I was 16.
Late in life, but you're doing pretty well with that name.
So out there, yeah.
That's what's up. But I do want to thank you for giving us a portion of your afternoon. So I definitely want to do that.
Yeah.
Respect your time.
Yeah, my pleasure.
All right. So first off, I want to say this. After watching some of your interviews, one in particular, this was sort of a spiritual epiphany for me. Mm-hmm. Seriously, you talk about how many people think that drug addicts or alcoholics are weak. You share an example of how addiction is like dancing with an 800-pound gorilla. You said that an 800-pound gorilla punched you in the face. People out there have this attitude that alcoholics and drug abusers are weak, no willpower, morally non-committal. And you also said, you show me anyone that has danced with the 800-pound gorilla that has been punched, that has been punching your face for 20 years and lived to tell a story, I'll show you one committed, willful person. And the reason why that is just was so special to me is that my mom had battled addictions all her life. And for my almost entire life, I thought that she was just the weakest person ever. So when I read that, I was like, wow.
Yeah. God bless your mother, first of all. Yeah. And I say that, I don't say that lightly, because I think, I mean, I grew up, my uncle was President Kennedy, and he was very sick much of his life, and, almost died many times, spent a lot of time in bed, struggled with this illness. We grew up with an ethic in my family. He read a lot of biographies and autobiographies, and he believed that in order to achieve great things in the world, you have to overcome something. We have millions of people who have overcome this illness and who struggle with this illness on a daily basis and yet still raise beautiful children, okay? And they do it, and they're not having a lot of fun doing it, you know? There's a misconception out there in society that addicts and alcoholics are having a good old time. Well, you try dancing with the 800-pound gorilla. Now, it's fun in the beginning.
Right.
Oh, it's a party in the beginning. But after a while, it's not fun anymore. And you have to do it, and you do it even though every ounce of you doesn't want to.
Right.
And it is difficult just to get out of bed, okay? Now, I used to think I had a big life out there when I was a drug addict.
Right.
And I couldn't get up off the couch.
Right.
I do more in a day today than I did in a month back then,
right.
Okay? And I went to college, I went to law school, I got a master's certification in clinical psychology from Harvard Medical School.
Right.
While fully enmeshed in my active addiction. We are exceptional people.
Mm-hmm.
We are exceptional people. Not just because of what we can do,
mm-hmm.
but because of our experience of overcoming, and also because many of us, you know, Carl Jung said it, and my friend Richard Dreyfuss says it, he goes, all alcoholics and addicts are trying to touch the hand of God. Mm. They're on a search for something other than, they're trying to get rid of their pain, they've got, you know, existential angst that they come here with, whatever they come here with, or they're searching.
Right.
And they have a lot to give the world.
They do.
Yeah. And it's time that the world paid attention.
Mm, I like
and stop discriminating and stigmatizing them about things that they don't know anything about. Right. Try walking in their shoes for 5 minutes and see how long it lasts.
I want to digress a little bit. You spent part of your childhood in Santa Monica. According to your book, Symptoms of Withdrawal, just one of your many books, page 18 to be specific, those were the happiest years of your life. Then you moved to the East Coast, living between two glamorous worlds where you found more temptations. Your redemption from substance abuse and hepatitis C are remarkable. You also overcome frustration, anger, and despair. So, Christopher, please share with us what is the essential lesson in all of that you learned.
Well, first of all, I think many people embark on a road like mine not because they want to, but because in adolescence they end up trying something that fills them in a way that they need to be filled. We know today from the science that a kid who suffers trauma in their adolescence and has a genetic predisposition towards this illness, this illness of addiction, has a much greater chance of developing the brain illness later in life. So many kids experiment. So my life, you know, growing up, I mean, I was a product of divorce. I moved from beautiful Santa Monica to New York City, which was a terrifying, cold place to me. Two of my uncles were brutally murdered in a public way. And so I had a lot of trauma. I didn't realize that at the time.
Right.
But I had a lot of trauma. And I was 14 years old when my friend said, hey, you want to try some LSD? And I said no for 8 months, and that after my Uncle Bobby was killed in Los Angeles. 2 months after that, I said yes. Now, did I say yes as a result of that murder? Absolutely.
Right.
Absolutely. I didn't know that at the time.
Mm-hmm.
But all around me was obliteration. All around me was pain. All around me was confusion. I was a terrified, angry kid, and I didn't know it.
Right.
Drugs and alcohol helped me. In a way, they saved my life. And then they almost killed me.
Mm.
I mean, that's the paradox. So today, you know, I don't regret any of my past.
Right.
I'm lucky to have survived it. Really lucky to have survived it and come out the other end. And actually, at 26 years clean and sober, I am, you know, one of the lucky ones.
Right.
Hello. I won the lottery.
Yes, you did.
I won the lottery.
You did. That's funny that you say that. I know I talk to my friends all the time. We talk about our kids and stuff. And I said that if I didn't have kids, my kids are the ones that really gave me my character. And I guess that would be the same thing when it comes to drugs or alcohol abuse for some people, because the trials and tribulations that you go through with it and, you know, just sticking it, you know, just recovering from it.
They inform who you are to a large degree. And let me be really clear about this. Because this illness, drugs and alcohol are merely a symptom of it.
Right.
It goes deeper than that. And those underlying causes and conditions need to be addressed.
Right.
So many people, Bill Wilson, who was the founder of Alcoholics Anonymous, said you sober up a horse thief, you've got a sober horse thief.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? So the truth is, many of us are childlike, are egocentric, are angry, are entitled. I have all of that. And part of life is accepting who you are and working to change it for the better so you're not a miserable guy and making everybody in your life miserable.
Right.
So fortunately for me, I had an orientation, not of my own design, towards a spiritual life. in the sense that I had to address principles in my life that would help me change who I was. Because if I stayed who I was, I would be a miserable guy. And I would have to use or kill myself.
Wow.
Okay, so the truth is, now, you can ask people in my life, and many of some of them will say, I've done a good job at that, and others will say, I haven't done a good job at
that.
Right. Mm-hmm. Okay, but that's okay. I'm okay with me today.
That's a beautiful thing to be okay with you. It definitely is. So you have lived a life many can only dream of. You live in your own lottery, you know, so to speak. Surrounded by the best of both worlds, politics and Hollywood. And so how did this directly impact your life, specifically in the times when you were struggling with that addiction? And what was your breaking point?
Well, let me say, I grew up in two very specific cultures. I wouldn't say they're the best cultures.
Right.
I would say be careful what you pray for if you're praying to get to either one of those places.
Yes.
Because it may happen for you, and then you'll be ripped, then you'll go from the frying pan into the fire.
Wow.
Yeah, because those are not good places.
Right.
They're not good places on a variety of reasons. Right. They bring out the worst in human nature.
Right, right.
The atmosphere that you're in both of those places can feed some of one's less noble attributes.
Yeah.
This is an illness, addiction is an illness that gets people in their adolescence.
Yes, it does.
And even younger today.
You just got me to think in regards to, because we are, of course, you know, right near Hollywood, and just everything that's going on with a lot of the young entertainers today. Yeah.
This is a brain illness.
Mm-hmm.
There are people that are actually sick with this illness, and we are feeding it as in public, in an orgy of public ridicule, and it's outrageous.
Mm-hmm.
And it shouldn't stand. This is the number one public health issue in the United States of America.
Right.
Okay, the numbers are staggering in terms of overdoses, in terms of traffic fatalities, in terms of adolescent suicide, all around this issue. And we're not talking about those. We're talking about Lindsay.
Right.
And it's not okay.
Right. A lighter note. I heard you were, and this is kind of going to be kind of fun, I heard you were taught how to do the twist by Marilyn Monroe.
I was.
Yes, so if you play a little music, I'm just kidding, we don't have music. I was going to
have
you do a thing or two.
That would be kind of dated. We could do something else we could do another kind of dance, because the twist, I don't even remember how to do it. It was such a, compared to what kids do now, it's ridiculous.
I don't even know what they do now.
Breakdance.
Oh my God!
Or the robot. Or
okay, can you break dance with him?
No, I can't. But I actually love dancing.
I'm gonna talk a little bit about this great event that's happening in New York on October 16th.
Yeah.
The Dizzy Gillespie Memorial event for jazz musicians specifically. I think that's so great.
Yeah.
So how did you find yourself in just?
I actually got an email.
Speaker?
I got an email from the woman who runs it, and she asked me, and I appreciate the opportunity to speak wherever I can speak, and I happen to be in New York at that time, and obviously, Dizzy Gillespie was an amazing a force in America, a musical force, and also a iconic force. I know a lot of folks who have struggled with this issue that were musicians and actors and stuff. So anything that any organization that does that kind of ministry to me is somebody I'd like to help.
Right, and I was going to say that exact same thing. So I definitely want to, and it came from Dr. Anna Isabel Ordonez.
Right.
She's doing some fascinating things, not just in music, and jazz music, but just all over the world, she's doing some great things.
Right.
So definitely kudos to her and the event.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Yeah.
You know, I'm looking forward to it. I hope a lot of folks come out and support the organization. If you're out there and you're in New York City and you can make it to that, we're going to give them where it is and all of that. That would be great. Come down and see me and see the rest of the folks at the foundation, but I'll or send them a check.
Right. Yeah, definitely. And yeah, it's October 16th. It's going to be at the Cotton Club in New York, and I'll be there too.
Cotton Club, yeah.
Yeah, so I'm definitely excited. And it's for the Dizzy Gillespie Memorial Fund. So you can actually go to, you can Google Dizzy Gillespie Memorial Fund for that direct link to that direct website where you can go ahead and make a donation. Send your checks in. They're doing so many outstanding things for jazz musicians. It was one thing in particular I wanted to read. The world will achieve to see one day addictions as real as social disease?
The short answer is yes. I mean, I think that we do understand, I think society understands this is a brain illness.
Right.
It is an illness that's in the brain and that we've established that scientifically.
Okay.
We understand there is a genetic component. We haven't identified the gene yet that tells you whether you might have it or not have it. Mm-hmm. But we do know that there is a genetic component to this, mm-hmm. and that we'll prove that someday.
Mm-hmm.
There's a lot of good science, which is going to change the way society views this thing. The American people in the studies that have been done really do believe, they feel for people that have this illness. They believe that they deserve treatment. They want them to get better, but they don't believe anybody ever gets better. Right? They don't believe, because they see Lindsay Lohan mm-hmm. going in and out. They see Charlie Sheen going in and out. They see these stories because that's the stories they see. Mm-hmm. They don't see me unless they come to a speech I make or they have, because nobody really wants me on TV talking about this.
Yeah.
They want to see train wrecks. Okay,
yeah.
So the truth is, and there are a lot of people who are in recovery who are big movie stars mm-hmm. and big rock stars and big this and big that. And many, I mean, Russell Brand does a lot of work now.
Right.
I mean, there are people that are out there doing some work. There are many people who aren't.
Right.
And in my opinion, maybe they ought to look at that.
Right.
Because we need them. Because this thing gets better when people that other people know say, it's okay. I had this, I don't have it anymore.
You're doing so many great things just with everything that you're doing, the books that you've written. You're a New York Times best-selling author, so kudos to you on that. You're doing so many great things. When I was reading your just biography.
It's been a privilege for me to do this. I mean, it's, you know, I spent a lot of time wasting what I was given.
Mm-hmm.
And so now to be able to utilize what I have to give something back is an enormous gift, and I'm grateful for it.
So is this part of like your global initiative that you're trying to push?
Yeah, I'm coming out with a book called Recover to Live in January, and it's a book about addictive disease.
Okay.
I interviewed 150 of the smartest people on the planet about it, so it's good information.
Yeah.
It's an assessment tool for folks, and it's also the ability for people to do something about this disease or begin the process of doing something about it on their own. They don't have to go to a treatment center or spend a lot of money or whatever. The idea being that we just need a conversation, we need some tools, and we need some visibility so people aren't so baffled by this.
Yeah.
It's something that they can actually do something about.
Right.
So I have that book coming out. I also have the Global Recovery Initiative, which is a nonprofit organization that's about promoting recovery. Because we know a lot about prevention, we know a lot about treatment, we don't know much about recovery because we don't spend any money or effort in figuring it out. There are a lot of people out there who know about it, and we're going to build a body of knowledge around recovery so people know that there's an alternative.
Right.
You know, kids, I mean, you know, when you're a kid and you're growing up and everybody's off getting high, what's the alternative to that?
Right.
You know, I mean, there, you know, sports is one. But, you know, there has to be a way for kids to socialize and be and still be okay with not getting high. The night is October.
October 16th.
October 16th. Everybody, October 16th, New York City, the Cotton Club. Come down, support this great foundation. They do really great work for musicians and folks who are struggling with this illness and other medical issues. So come down and support them.
Yeah, definitely. And actually, you can email me for ticket information at pr@eotmradio.com. pr@eotmradio.com. We definitely want to see you there. If you're in New York, at the Cotton Club, you know, you can get your jiggy thingy on, and she'll meet some twister moves or something. Definitely. Again, thank you so much, Christopher Kennedy Lawford.
Thank you.
And it's been a pleasure.
Pleasure. Pleasure's mine. Thank you. We'll be right back.